no matter what environmental indicator we're looking at, the global scale, the environment is doing worse than ever. Tropical forest loss, ocean acidification, biodiversity loss, surface temperature, freshwater use, and many others have been steeply increasing since 1950s. At the same time, Hans Rosling, a doctor and a geographer, has said that the world is getting a better place to live. He also based his argument on data. Since 1950s, child mortality has dropped from 20 to 4%. Hunger and child labor has plummeted as well. Basic education, among many other indicators, have increased rapidly. These two issues are naturally not in isolation from each other. Contrary, they are very much interlinked. The human being is flourishing on the coast of nature. My name is Matti Kummu. I work as an associate professor in the School of Engineering. I started my research on looking at the human impact on water resources at different scales, working with water stress, water shortage, among many other issues. I soon realized that if we want to solve water's crisis, among many other environmental crises, we need to turn the focus on food production. Therefore, the title of my talk is Global Food Futures: Opportunities Towards Sustainable Food Supply. Food production is the largest single sector modifying our planet. Over half of the global oceans are under fishing pressure. We use more than one third of the global land area for food production. And 70 to 90% of the water used by humans is used for irrigation to produce food. The future is not bringing ease to a situation. Population is expected to reach 10 billion by 2050. However, the distribution of the growth is not uniform. In Africa, for example, population is expected to double to 2 billion people by then, whereas in many countries in Europe, as well as in Russia and Japan, the trend is opposite. At the same time, the population gets wealthier, which often means that they eat more meat, which has much higher environmental footprint in average to that than the plant-based diets. Climate change will bring another challenge to the food production. In many areas, it will decrease the food production. For example, in Mediterranean, North America, and South Asia, might decrease the food production up to 30-40%. If we put these issues together, the future seems more than challenging. We cannot increase the use of natural resources. On contrary, we should ease the pressure. At the same time, there are more and more people to be fed in climatic conditions that are uncertain and unpredictable. But luckily, we have many opportunities to tackle the challenge, being one of the largest, probably, what human being has ever faced. These opportunities include so-called traditional opportunities, such as food loss reduction, diet change towards plant-based diet, better management of nutrients, better efficient in irrigation, as well as breeding crop types to better tackle the changing environment. There are also novel technologies such as cultured meat, vertical farming, which are showing very promising results. In our team, we have been doing pioneer work on global scale on estimating the potential of diet chains and food loss reduction. We were also the first team to be able to assess, with the use of state-of-the-art mathematical models, the combined potential of the traditional opportunities to increase the food supply. We found that moderate implementation of these opportunities would increase the food supply over 100%. In other words, we could double the food production without using more resources than we are using today. The theoretical maximum would even be able to triple the food supply. But we found also importantly that different countries, they have different opportunity strategies to be used. For example, in Finland, the largest potential lies in diet change and food loss reduction, as does in many other European countries, North America and Australia. Whereas in almost any other country, the largest potential lies in the so-called yield cap closure, which means that the better use of water and nutrients, they could reach the optimum yields in their fields. However, the resources used today is not sustainable. So it's not enough that we use similar amount of resources for food production. We need to decrease the pressure on the environment. So a U-turn is needed. In another research we were part of, we explored this U-turn. We first tested how much the current food production system could provide food while respecting the planetary boundaries of nitrogen, water, land, and biodiversity, meaning the sustainable use of these resources and respecting the biodiversity. We found that the current food system could provide food for only a bit more than 3 billion people, less than half of the current population. At the same time, however, if we would advance sustainably within the planetary boundaries and take advantage of the opportunities mentioned earlier, we could provide food for more than 10 billion people. But this would require huge changes, not only how and where we produce food, but also what we eat. The main goal of my research is trying to bring the humanity and nature closer together, so that the both could flourish at the same time. We are doing our part of this challenge by developing the next generation global food system models. These models would integrate all the food opportunities, both the novel innovations and traditional opportunities, in a way that the resources used would be sustainable and all would be socially feasible. As the end result, we envision having a so-called food opportunity menus, which could be used to deliver a message what kind of opportunities in each subnational unit globally would have to provide sustainably and socially feasibly enough healthy food for everyone.